We have Yashwardhan Kukreja with us. He'll be talking about writing your own Kubernetes operator in Python with Kopf to enhance and harden your Kubernetes clusters. So Yashwardhan, the stage is all yours.
Sure. Thanks a lot. So hi, everyone. I'm Yashwardhan, and I hope you had a great time with all the talks till now. So today I'll be talking about writing your own Kubernetes operators in Python with this framework called Kopf to enhance and harden your clusters. So moving on, let me first of all introduce myself. So I'm Yashwardhan, and currently I'm working as a site reliability engineer at Red Hat. And in my free time, I love to do open source dev around my favorite cloud native tools. Also, I love to read about distributed systems, astrophysics, and just to break the programmatic technological monotony, I love to do long distance cycle rides as well. So moving on, let's just super quickly talk about what Kubernetes is, because it's the most fundamental piece of tech in our talk, right? So Kubernetes is basically a container orchestrator. And assuming that you have a very basic idea about Docker containers, so I'll just keep the lingo in terms of containers only. So yeah, basically Kubernetes manages, schedules, and basically automates a lot of managerial manual stuff around dealing with containerized deployments. So just spinning up your containers in a reliable manner, deploying your applications on containers reliably, managing them, even debugging them and architecturizing them in a very mature manner is done with the help of Kubernetes alongside other countless things. So, but from a system administrator standpoint, it saves a lot of time and effort. So moving on. So basically Kubernetes, it's safe to say that Kubernetes is one of the, like, it's the most majorly adopted container orchestration platform out there. This means that it serves a heck lot of functionalities and use cases out there. But for a business, like at times you might have some custom requirements from Kubernetes, which are not natively present into it. So the beauty of Kubernetes, and actually one of the best things of Kubernetes, is that it's very pluggable in nature, which means that you can actually develop your own add-ons and plugins, which are programmed to perform some custom functionality. And they can be very easily integrated as a part of the Kubernetes stack itself. And another great part is that you can even use some third-party plugin or add-on to serve this functionality. So these add-ons and plugins are called operators. So basically, an operator resembles a human operator in the sense that it keeps on, you know, watching a cluster for some certain events happening. Like, for example, some resources getting created or deleted or updated, and accordingly performing tasks as a response to that, right? So, and basically, if you look at a Kubernetes cluster and see that, okay, as a system administrator, I'm performing one manual repetitive task again and again and again, then that serves as an opportunity to write an operator. Now, if it seems slightly complex, don't worry. I'll exemplify this further for you, right? So, but before moving on, let me just first of all quickly talk about custom resource definitions. So if you have even a very slight idea of Kubernetes, you know that Kubernetes has a lot of resources, right? Like pod, deployment, stateful set, replication controller, etc. So similarly, you can actually create your own custom resources as well, which means that if you have a custom resource with the name my custom resource, you can actually write YAML with the kind my custom resource. You can actually kubectl get my custom resource. But to actually make your Kubernetes cluster aware of this custom resource, you define it first of all, right? And how do you define it? Well, you define it with this file called custom resource definition. So basically, it resembles the schema of your custom resource, because of course, your custom resource, when you'll write a YAML for it, it will have a structure, right? So the custom resource definition will encapsulate all the information around your custom resource. For example, what is its name? What is its, basically structure, etc., etc. And then your operator behind the scenes will watch for these custom resources. And whenever these custom resources are created, updated, or deleted, the logic of what's going to be performed, that's going to be written inside the operator. So operator is kind of like the backend side of custom resources, whereas these custom resources are the front end side of, you know, the user. So moving on. So if I give you a very simple example, and actually this is what we're going to implement today in the talk. So if you look at carefully, you know, in front of your screen, you can see that there's a YAML defined, right? And if you look carefully, it's a custom resource. This is not a native resource in Kubernetes, right? Like the API version is my name, the kind is Postgres iter. And basically what this custom resource is meant to do is that whenever it gets applied, now the table field inside it and the other values like name, age, country inside it are fetched by Kubernetes and then return to a remote Postgres database in the provided table. And the logic to do so, the logic to actually parse this custom resource and parse the table value, parse the name edge country values, and then create an insert query and write to the Postgres, that logic is programmed in the operator. So operator is kind of like backendish in that sense. So how can we write on our own operators? Well, in Golang, there are very sophisticated and great libraries such as Client Go and even Controller Runtime, which can be used to write operators. But they're pretty complicated. But even to help us further, there are really amazing projects like Cube Builder, Operator SDK, which in just one command basically establishes the whole boilerplate code for you. But the problem is that although they set up your whole project for you, bootstrap the project for you, they are still complicated and hectic to deal with because there are a lot of Go files, packages, and whatnot. So as usual, Python comes to the rescue. In Python, there is a very awesome framework called Kopf, which is Kubernetes Operator Pythonic Framework. And it is a framework with which you can write Kubernetes operators from scratch using Python with utter ease. And I mean, there are no extra files. Like literally, to write a basic operator, you need one Python file and one Docker file. That's it. Like that's the beauty. And all of you know how straightforward Python is as a language, so the convenience is top-notch. So I hope you folks are hyped enough. So let's dive in and code our own operator, right? So as I exemplified, right, about Postgres writer, so we're going to be implementing this one only. So let's move on. So first of all, we have to, like, let me just again present to you how our custom resource is going to look into action. So after everything is ready, as a user of this operator, as a user of this custom resource, I'll just simply write this custom YAML, apply it over my cluster, and behind the scenes, some magic is going to happen. And in my Postgres database, this row will be created. And I will also program a logic to ensure that whenever this custom resource is deleted from my cluster, automatically that deletion is synchronized in the Postgres database by deleting this row. So moving on. So as a first step, first of all, we have to make Kubernetes aware that, okay, what is this kind Postgres writer? What is this demo.yash.com, right? So for that, we'll define the CRD. Now, don't get freaked out. It's a very simple CRD. I'll just quickly go over it, right? So first of all, everything has a name. So even custom CRD has a name. And the name has a format, right? So the name has to be in the form of your resource name in plural form dot group. Now, what is a group? Well, let me just go back quickly and notice the API version, right? So if you notice the API version, it is in a format. The format is group/version. So the group is demo.yash.com and version in my case is v1 and kind is Postgres writer. So these are group version kind, and together a group version kind basically, acts like a unique ID of a resource in your cluster. So in my case, in this situation, the GVK, the group version kind is demo.yash.com v1 Postgres writer. So that's what I'm doing here. The metadata, the name of the, basically the CRD is the plural form of my resource, which is Postgres writers dot group. Inside the spec, I've defined the group, which is demo.dash.com, which I just explained. And inside the version, I've defined v1. So your CRD can have, your custom resource can have multiple versions depending on the functionalities. Now inside this version v1, I'm actually defining the structure of the YAML to expect. So if you look carefully, the structure here is expecting a spec section. Inside it, there are four fields called table, name, age, country, and each of them have a data type, right? Table has a string data type, age has an integer data type, etc. So all of this stuff is defined carefully inside the schema. You can see that, okay, there is a required field spec, and there are required fields like table, name, age, country with their respective data types. Then at an operator, at a custom resource level, I've defined the scope as namespace. Basically, this means that I can apply this resource over different namespaces. You can also have some certain, use cases where you want just your custom resource to operate at the cluster-wide level, not specifically like at a namespace level. And if you're aware of cluster roles and cluster role bindings, they are similar in that sense, but don't worry. So in my case, the scope is namespaced. And finally, I've defined the name of my operator, of my custom resource, right? So the plural is going to be Postgres writers, singular is going to be Postgres writer, kind is going to be the Postgres writer in a camel case, and short name is PSW. So all of these names are basically, for doing kubectl get Postgres writer, kubectl get PSW, etc. So this, I promise this was the complicated part. Now begins the fun part. So first of all, now comes the, now Now, once we define our CRD, we are done with, telling Kubernetes that how our custom resource will look. But still, what's going to happen behind the scene? That will be coded in our operator. And this is where we begin. So first of all, we'll import the relevant libraries. So the first one, the psycopg2, this is for, talking to Postgres database and, inserting and deleting stuff. Kopf is basically a framework to write operators. And then Kubernetes library is being used to basically, make our operator communicate with our cluster, right? And finally, the OS library to get environment variables. Now, the first function basically I've written is that to initialize DB. So basically, of course, first of all, you have to establish a connection with the database, right? So I've already set up a database of Postgres on this specific IP. This is just a toy, setup. But in a more mature and productionized manner, you should have a dedicated setup where you are injecting the host name and sensitive fields like passwords in a secure mechanism. But in this case, this function is returning me the connection to the database. The second function is initialize queue. And it is doing one thing. It is basically establishing the connection between my operator and the Kubernetes cluster so that my operator can talk to Kubernetes cluster and accordingly, watch for the custom resource and take actions. Now you might see that there is an if and else present here. Now the thing is that you can run your operator in two ways. First of all is obviously you can just package it as a Docker image and deploy it on your container or deploy it on your cluster, which is the normal productionized way. But while developing an operator as a developer, right, it's hectic to every time when a code changes, you package it as a Docker image and deploy it. So for the sake of convenience, you can literally run your operator locally through command line, and it will talk to your Kubernetes cluster via kubeconfig. So whenever you do kubectl got get something, it like that thing is routed through your kubeconfig, right? So similarly, this operator will perform at that level as well. So I'm just defining, a dev environment variable to tell my code that okay, how to talk to my Kubernetes cluster, when I'm developing locally or I've deployed it. So moving on. Now this is the main helper function which will insert a row into the table. It is very straightforward. It is just performing an insert query into my database. It is taking my database connection ka variable and feeding the table name, the name, age, country into it, and just throwing that piece of row inside my table. And as I told later, we're going to be handling the deletes as well in a graceful manner. So I've defined a function to delete data as well. And again, it's a super super easy delete query, right? So now moving on. Now this is the belle of the ball. This is the piece of code. This is a function which will watch for the creation of my custom resource. Don't worry, I'll explain it. So if you look at the first line, I'm just like it's very self-explanatory, right? I'm just telling conf.onCreate, and then inside I'm defining the GVK. Again, remember what GVK was? It was group version kind. So whenever conf, basically my operator, whenever it will notice the creation of a resource of this GVK, of this group version kind, then it's going to execute the following piece of code. And the following piece of code is basically extract doing nothing but extracting the table name, the name, the age and country fields, and throwing them inside the table of the Postgres database, which my operator is aware of. And I'm also, by the way, like behind the scenes, I'm also, while inserting the data, I'm also defining a primary key called ID. And that is nothing, just, the resource you are applying now. That resource is namespace slash name, just for the sake of establishing uniqueness. So if I just go super quickly back, you see that this table, right, this record which got created, you see the ID how it looks. It is namespace slash the resource name, the one which is defined here. So that's just for the sake of, keeping things unique and graceful so as to avoid any conflicts. So yeah, again, this operator, whenever it captures a create event of this GVK of my Postgres writer, it will essentially, parse the table name, age, country fields, and throw them into my database. Similarly, whenever it will catch the deletion of a resource of Postgres writer, my custom resource, it's gonna again capture the spec of the resource which got deleted, and accordingly, look at the namespace and name, and accordingly delete the corresponding row which was present in the database, just to synchronize things and ensure that the database contains only those rows, those records which are actually present in the Kubernetes cluster in the form of Postgres writer resources. And running the operator locally, again, as a developer, you can run the operator locally with this command called kopf run then your Python file, and it's gonna run beautifully. So let's just quickly hop back to our terminal, right? So let me just actually terminals have, because my display is 2K, so I'm afraid it's not going to be visible to you folks. Let me just, I hope the display is now fine. Perfect. Okay, cool. So right now I'm inside my project folder, and first of all, let me just show you. Let me actually, get client level access to my Postgres database. So right now this Postgres database has, this table called students, which I already created, and basically, so yeah, it is. Just a second. Just a second. Let's select.
Yashwardhan, I think the font size
Yeah.
is too small. Could you please increase?
Oh sure, I'll increase it further. How is it now?
A little better, but
Refresh.
it can be.
I mean, it should be readable now, I guess, at least. Or is it still not? Or I guess I've increased it on my end, but it hasn't synchronized on your end. Is it still not enough?
It
Because
is
it's
better
covering
now.
most of
It
my
is
screen.
better now. It is better now.
Okay. I guess it was delayed a little bit. Anyways, never
Okay,
mind.
okay.
So if you look at back to the talk. So if you look at the left terminal, you can see that I have a table created, and the students table doesn't have any, rows and stuff. Now I'll do one thing. I'll run my operator locally. And but before running an operator, again, let's go stepwise. Let's first of all create the CRD, right? So I'll just create the CRD again. Again, the CRD file looks like exactly like the one which I demonstrated in the PPT. So I'll just kubectl apply CRD and done. Now if I quickly do kubectl get CRD, so my CRD exists, right? Now if I now before applying my custom resource, right? Let's first of all start the operator, because Kubernetes has to be aware that what's going to happen when the resource is created. So in the lower terminal, I've set the dev is equal to true environment variable, and now quickly I'll run my operator. Perfect. So now this is a sign of the operator running successfully. And if I define the sample.yaml, basically the sample.yaml, is the exact custom PostgreSQL file which I'll apply now. And carefully notice the values. The table is students, the namespace is, oh sorry, name is sample student, and namespace is default. So if I let me just keep it here, and if I apply the sample.yaml, yep, it got applied, and you see some logs are captured here. And now if I go back to my left wallet terminal and actually see that if my database got updated or not. Yep, see the data got reflected. So behind the scenes, exactly the way it was expected to happen, the way it worked. And similarly, if I do kubectl get Postgres writers, you can see that in the default namespace this resource got created. Now if I delete my this Postgres writer, right, and sample student, oopsies, yep, it got deleted. And again, the operator was able to catch this deletion, and hopefully it deleted the row in the database. And if I go in the database and actually do select star from students, perfect. So the creations were synchronized well with the database, and the deletions were synchronized well with the database. Now this is like, this proves that the operator is working perfectly fine. Now this, but still, this is like the way I executed the operator. It was very local developmental way, right? So we have to deploy it the right way, right? So your operator in a productionized manner has to be first of all packaged into a Docker image and deployed over a cluster. And then in that cluster, it will run as a, this thing, a pod, and serve the functionality which it is supposed to. So but before, so let me just create a namespace called Postgres, where I'll be keeping all the resources associated with my operator. And if you notice, I have a deployment defined, which basically, contains, which basically, encapsulates the logic to run the, my basically my operator. And my operator's image is going to be Postgres hyphen writer. So first of all, let's quickly build the image of my operator. So I'm building the image of my operator, and yep, it's built. And ignore this last command which I'm executing. I'm just making use of this tool called kind for Kubernetes testing. So ignore this last command which I executed. But yeah, I'm packaging the Docker image with the name Postgres writer latest. And once I apply this deployment YAML, right, my operator will be spun up as a replica, as a pod actually. And this pod will actually serve this whole core functionality of the operator. But before that, we have to also provide our operator enough permissions to, you know, watch over this custom resource and take those necessary actions. Because Kubernetes, like, does not believe a new incoming piece of code, incoming piece of operator. So I'm doing one thing. I'll first of all define a thing called a service account. And that service account is basically defining something like an account with the name Postgres writer. And the next thing I'll do is that with the help of a cluster role binding, I'm going to correlate admin level permissions with this service account. So never do this in production. I'm just doing it, you know, for the sake of convenience. But in reality, you should only correlate the minimum amount of permissions with your operator. But yeah, in my case, for the sake of convenience, I'm just correlating the cluster admin role with this service account with the help of a cluster role binding. So if you see, the name of the cluster role binding is admin access. The service account it's going to point to is Postgres writer, and the role which it's going to point the service account to, it's going to be cluster admin. So once I define it, now my Kubernetes cluster is aware that whenever the service account, you know, Postgres writer will be used, it's going to correlate to admin level permissions. And if you notice carefully in the deployment file of my operator, you'll notice that I've defined the service account name, which means that the pod which will, you know, run my operator, it will have the accesses associated with this service account called Postgres writer, which indirectly has admin level accesses, right? So now I'll run a deployment and hopefully it runs. So it got created. Now let me do pods Postgres. Gorgeous. So it's running fine. Like the running status is a awesome green signal, right? Now let me just screen the logs of this deployment and see the logs are here as well. So again, we're going to do the same thing. We have already defined the CRD, so we won't reapply. So we will again apply, basically the sample YAML of the student, which I applied previously for the sake of example. And before that, just to confirm again, this students table does not have any rows, right? Again, it does not have any rows. So once I apply this custom sample, the student got created, and you can see that actually the logs were captured. And if I again hop back to my Postgres terminal, the resource were created. Now this is a perfectly working operator which is perfectly deployed in a productionized manner, right? And if I delete this resource, then again logs were captured by my pod, my operator's pod. And if I look back into my Postgres terminal, the rows were deleted. So everything is working perfectly fine. Just one thing, just a few things I would like to mention. See, the piece of code which I wrote, actually it's not very mature piece of code because I just want to demonstrate how an operator works, right? But in reality, you would have to handle exceptions in a graceful way, ensuring conflicts and whatnot. So just a heads up regarding that. Also, the deployment file which I wrote, okay, wait, I'm already inside the folder. Yeah, so if you notice, okay, my terminal is messing up. Yeah, if you notice, I'm providing the password and the username and all this config directly as plain text. Never do that. Please never do that. Please always inject your environment variables in the form of config maps and secrets accordingly. Although secrets don't exactly encrypt your data, they encode it, but yeah, it doesn't matter. Conventionally, you should inject your environment variables in the form of config map references and secrets. So again, I did not do that here just to keep things convenient and straightforward for you. But yeah, just to keep the things out there. So this was my presentation. And so the key takeaways from this presentation is that we saw what Kubernetes operators are and why are they so cool. And we also learned about CRDs. We delved deeper into coding our own Postgres writer operator and deploying it. And we also, you know, see like how we actually practically saw in the terminal how things worked out. And you can check out this slide deck, the code to the above operator on my GitHub profile with the name Yashvardhan-Kukreja, Yashvardhan-Kukreja. And that's pretty much it. And also one more thing, actually, I forgot to mention. You might have noticed that, you know, for deploying our operator, it was pretty complicated, like installing service account, cluster role binding, deployment, right? So all of this stuff can be automated as well. And there are a lot of tools out there to, you know, automate this stuff. So one of the most commonly used tool is called Helm. It's spelled HELM. And basically, it abstracts away all this useless, user, like from the user standpoint, all this useless stuff like service accounts, deployment, role bindings, etc. And all the, as a user, what I have to do, I just have to provide my, basic variables. Like, for example, my Postgres host, username, and password, and that's it. REST Helm will handle for me. It will automatically feed in my variables into this deployment, automatically apply them, set up the namespaces, etc. So do check out the Helm project as well. So I guess we still have around 2 to 3 minutes left, or 3 to 4 minutes left for taking any questions. So yeah, I'm up for questions, and also I'm free to reach out to on my Twitter and on my GitHub and on my LinkedIn as well. Although I haven't put it up here, but yeah. So any questions, feel free to shoot him. Girish, I guess I can take up some questions if there are
Yeah,
any.
there are questions coming in. The first question is, can I use Kubernetes operator instead of using job when I'm deploying a backend application? And I want to run the PostScript operations like migration settings, etc.
Sorry, can you repeat the question? Your voice broke a little bit, I guess, on my end.
Okay, so the question was, can I use Kubernetes operators instead of using job when I'm deploying a backend application, and I want to run the PostScript operations like migrations.
Yeah, so see, I guess this is a very simple use case. And I guess if I were in a position, I would have written a simple cron job only. See, because the thing is that in your use case, right, you do not need to necessitate upon establishing a custom resource and, basically making use of the reconciliation logic of Kubernetes, right? So, okay, I'll give you like a certain use case or, basically a perspective where you can see and actually notice that, okay, I can use operators. So operators, don't look at operators as something which your application developers would use. Rather, look at them, what are cluster administrators you would use, right? So for example, as a cluster administrator, if you are manually performing some administrative task on a cluster and they are very manual, repetitive, toily, then you can write an operator to automate and manage that. But the application level stuff, like basically performing some script operations or a basic script which happens periodically, the Kubernetes cron job will do most of the job very easily.
Okay. The second question is, what are implications of providing all permissions in cl a cluster role binding while op application deployed in production scenario?
Oh my God, it's very messy actually. Because again, see, like most of the times you're going to be actually making use of third-party operators, right? So in that case of scenario, if someone is malicious, they can actually inject a piece of code in their operator code to, maybe inspect all the resources in a cluster, inspect the secrets in a cluster, and dump them somewhere out there, right? So that's risky. And even like let's say if you are not even using someone else's operator and using your own operator, and you are sure that it's it's basically you're not going to do something malicious, but still, the fact that you are providing admin level privileges to your operator means that your blast radius for making a mistake in your operator increases. So by mistake, if you coded something messy in your operator which performs some deletion in your cluster, right? So there would be anything there like a gateway to stop it from doing that. So just to avoid the risk of your own human prone mistakes or someone else being getting malicious unprivileged access to your cluster, please do ensure that the level of service account and the roles assigned to the operator are minimal.
Right. There is one more question. What are the performance implications of using Python and Python to write an operator as opposed to writing one, say, in Golang?
Honestly, I haven't like benchmarked both of them any. And honestly, in my previous organizations, we heavily use Python-based operators and Golang-based operator as well. See, there are fundamental performance benefits of Golang, right? Because it's like directly compiles into machine code and it has great performance level benefits. But I guess at the framework level, there is not much difference. And honestly, like in my previous company called Grofers, we actually heavily used our operators in which were written in Kof, and there weren't any alarming or critically slow issues with Python which caused us any issues. So there are very minimal differences. But from my experience, dealing with Golang and the level of simplicity and concurrent control it provides, I would prefer Golang to code operators, and the performance benefits are also more than Python for obvious reasons.
Okay, I think there is one. Can you define some use cases for Python operators that you use personally?
Yeah, so for example, this Postgres writer one, right? So this is exactly like something very similar to this we used in a previous organization. But instead of that, so basically in a previous organization, we used a software called Consul KV for basically this thing called configuration management. And we wanted to establish a practice where people, instead of directly writing their key value pairs over their Consul web portal, they instead applied them on Kubernetes and some operator fetched them and threw them into Consul. So this interfacing, and for this we created our own operator. And apart from there are countless operators, right? For example, Aquasic. Oh, sorry. Yeah. For example, there is an operator called Starboard, which is provided by this company called Aqua Security, with which basically which constantly watches for your incoming deployments and pods and actually inspects them to see that if they are vulnerable or not. For example, if they are having unprivileged is equal to true, or host network mode is on, something like that. So these kinds of use cases.
I think we are almost out of time. We can take one more question, and that is, can I interact with other resources slash CRDs using a CRD I write?
Yes, you can do that. So see, again, operator is just a fancy term. Behind the scenes, this thing is a controller which we wrote, right? An operator is basically a controller which is watching over CRDs. So what you are saying is that you are basically writing a controller which watches over other custom resources. So of course you can do that. The way I defined in the PPT, right? If I go super quickly, so here I defined the GVK of this my resource, right? I could have defined the other custom resources as well, and then my operator would be watching the other resource and taking actions accordingly upon their creation, updation, or deletion. So yeah, of course you can do that.
Right. So yeah, we are out of time. So I think there are more questions. I think we'll have to take those offline.